What's going on YouTube? This is Ipsec, and this video is going to be all about PHP type juggling and why you should be using 3 equals versus 2 equals in your PHP applications. Now, I think other languages do have 3 equals, but the whole type juggling confusion thing isn't as prevalent in other languages as it is PHP, and in this video, we'll dig into why. This video was also recorded in front of a live Twitch audience. I generally stream Sunday mornings. You can just go to my Twitch TV channel, Ipsec, click on the calendar and find the next time I'll be streaming if you want to see me live. And since this clip is highly relevant to bug bounty, Integrity reached out and wanted to sponsor the video, which I can't thank them enough for because number one, it motivates me to create more content. And number two, it lets me have some money to pay some graphics designers to make thumbnails for me, which I absolutely hate doing. So big thanks to Integrity, which is a bug bounty platform. We'll get more into them later, but for now, let's just get into the video. So we have a web application here, and if we try to log in, it just keeps telling us invalid login. Now, the very first step with any web application is trying to identify what it's running on in the backend, because that will tell you what type of attacks you can do. In here, we don't really have that many hints in the source code, but if we send this over to Burp Suite and do a login, let me make sure I'm intercepting. We can see it's got a Laravel session cookie. And this is important because it does tell us it's PHP. And PHP does have a really hilarious type confusion bug, and that is the like triple equals thing. So if we do php-a and we say if a is equal to a, and then we just do echo true, it's going to echo true. Now, if we say A is equal to true, it's still going to echo true. Now, if we said false, it's going to say false. If we say A is equal to 0, it's going to echo true as well because 0 is true. It's like the normal exit codes. So what this is doing is essentially saying if A is not empty. Because I think that's generally how PHP treats strings or variables. Like if we say, we'll call ipsec equals test. I think I have to put a dollar sign first, right? So now we have ipsec echo ipsec. We have this. And if I do my if then, so if I just do if ipsec, I think it's going to echo true. Because it's not empty. If I change this and we do the same thing, it's no longer true because the string is empty. So that is essentially what's going on with this type confusion thing. If you want to patch it, PHP, whenever you do comparisons, most likely you want to do a strict thing or a strict comparison and do a triple equals because that's going to compare the value plus the type of variable it is. In this case, we're comparing like a string to a Boolean and it's saying, nope, that's not the same. So that's the vulnerability. It doesn't affect a lot of languages, right? So if I do like Python 3 and we can say if A is equal to A, I think this is right, print success, that works. But if we do A is equal to true, it doesn't. Maybe we need a capital T there. It doesn't work, right? Because Python isn't vulnerable to this piece. JavaScript, let's see. We can try test JavaScript. I actually don't know. Let's do if A is equal to A, then console log. Success. I think that's the right JavaScript syntax. That works. So now we're going to change this to be true, right? And we get undefined. Let's do a lowercase t. Still, we don't see it saying success. So it's not vulnerable to this. Let's see. Ruby? Oh, God. If A is equal to A. Is it just like this? Ruby, I think, is print success end. Sweet. So it printed success right here. Let me just success two. There we go. I just want to make sure like that wasn't a default thing. So I remembered how to do an if statement in Ruby. Awesome. True. Whoops. Let's change this. Still, it's not saying success. So we can see this is relatively unique to PHP. And all of these languages have quirks. So that's why I'm always saying like recon is super important. Just knowing what the language is may help you. So now let's go with how to exploit this. And then we'll look at the vulnerable code on the back end. I'm going to send this over to my repeater. And we know this is Laravel. There are two indications we're going to the API in Laravel. The first, we have /API. The second, we don't have a token variable. Generally, Laravel, for any type of web form you submit, has protected a cross-site request forgery, and it does it by putting a token in the actual field. So the fact that there's no token also means we're going to the API middleware, and that's just what like PHP, or I guess Laravel calls it as middleware. We're going into Laravel's thing to process an API request. And this is interesting to us because APIs behave a little bit differently than the normal user input. The very first thing is the APIs essentially accept data in either the GET portion or the body. So if we put that down here, password field is required because we're missing the content type probably. If I convert this selection, let's see, where is change request method? So I was probably missing this content type to tell it it was URL encoded. If I send this, we see method not allowed. It doesn't like post request. But if I change this to a GET, password field is still required. I wonder if I take off this XML HTTP header. We can see different behavior. So we can put data here. I wonder if I leave this blank. If I leave this completely blank, it looks like it still does something. So maybe this piece isn't interesting. But if I change this to application JSON, and it was, let's see, what was the actual request? Just password is equal to something. So let's put password. Let's see, a server timeout. I don't know what my burp suite just did there. Let's just get to a good spot again. I probably didn't have two line breaks at the end of this, and then it waited a while, and then when it timed out, it put my window back to how it was before I did the request that timed out, which is annoying. But we're gonna change this URL encoded to just be JSON, and now we can say password, I think it was a lowercase p, is equal to ipsec. And we see invalid password. If I didn't put this as password, we get that weird redirecting thing. So we know it's accepting this password as JSON. And now this is really interesting to us because now that we're in JSON, we can change this type, right? Like if I just did password is equal to true here, now we're passing a boolean because we didn't put it in quotes. We don't have a way to do that this way because the field is always going to be a string. It's just like typecasted that way or whatever. Like it's just like, nope, we're not going to use quotes here. It's just going to behave as a string. But as JSON, we have to put the quotes there for it to be a string. And if we don't, it gets treated as a different type of variable. In this case, it's getting treated as a boolean and we get login successful. So if I do, I could also do it with zero, right? Because we said zero is equal to true, and there we go. If I do one, we get invalid password. So now that we're login successful, we could just take a cookie and edit it in, or we can take what we did and proxy an actual request. So I'm going to drop all these, refresh this. Actually, let's not refresh. Let's just click, come on, intercept off, on. I'm gonna log in with ipsec, click it. Now we're intercepting this request. We're going to go to a repeater tab. We're going to grab this field and just paste it in. And take off this. And I always like password is equal to true. And we just click forward. And now we get logged into this application. So let's take a look at the source code real quick before we wrap this one segment up. Apologies for the sloppy cut, but I want to take a minute or two and highlight Integrity, which is Europe's number one ethical hacking and bug bounty platform. So you can take anything you learn in my videos or just what you know in the cybersecurity or hacking in general, search through all their bug bounty platform partners, and apply that knowledge and earn cash, which is a great way to make a living or just earn a little bit of side income. Now, I like Integrity's platform, but the main thing I like about Integrity is their community engagement. So we can go over to their filters, where you could filter for like bounty to see all the partners that give you money. But I'm going to go to sustainable because I know Integrity would be near the top. And I just wanted to highlight that they do monthly challenges. So this one is a cross-site scripting. We can go here. If we go to the link, we can see they have 3 randomly drawn winners and 3 best write-ups to get a 50 euro swag voucher. It's just a simple cross-site scripting test. And if you find a way to perform cross-site scripting, that's how you get entered to win. And if you just struggle like me probably on this challenge and don't come up with a solution, then just wait for them to publish one and learn new things to apply to these bug bounty platforms. But they don't stop with community there. They have a huge YouTube channel, and I like a lot of the videos. You can see I watched this time-based blind one where I learned something new about Burp Suite, and he used the intruder feature to do a time-based blind SQL query, which I knew how to do. You just send a bunch of requests and look for the one that took the longest. But he shows you how you can increment the character automatically, so with like one intruder query, you can dump a whole password through SQL blind injection. It's really cool Burp magic that he does in that video. If we go to home, we can see their cross-site scripting solution, how they do it. So that's where you can learn there. And again, the community doesn't just stop at their YouTube. 5 years ago, they made this Medium post. I'm sure they have a lot of them. But this one in particular is what inspired me to create the delivery machine. So their little community engagement 5 years ago inspired me to create a machine just 1 year ago. So all the work they do for the community definitely pays off. I do love them as a company. But let's get back to the video. And again, this is on my live streams, which I do Sundays at 8 a.m. my time. If you just go to my Twitch TV on IPSEC, you can look at the calendar and see the next time I'm going live. I generally don't put the VODs online, but let's see. I think I can SSH root. Nah, probably HTTP at, what was that IP? 10.10.11.153. And if you do the box, you end up getting these credentials. So, yeah. But we're just going to skip it so we can see the actual source code. So I think I put it in SOV. Yep, there we go, prod. Now we're in the actual application. Laravel, if we go to routes, I think API, we can see the login route is using the function custom login. So if I go, let's see, app, HTTP, controllers, auth controller, and we have custom login right here. So this is the vulnerable code. This is the actual root password of the box, but we can see we're taking the request get password and doing comparison with 2 equals against this string. And like we saw before during the PHP, we know if we had this to be true, we pass in and get success. Now, where we see this in actual applications, anytime like a string is being compared, like registration codes, the hack the box flags would do it. It's normally not a login bypass because generally how logins work is they look for the number of rows retrieved from a login request. Also, like when someone does a login in Laravel, they're not handwriting the SQL. They're just essentially passing it to Laravel's backend to do a login function. And that's why you should always be using frameworks, because frameworks are rarely vulnerable. So you just want to look at where comparisons would be made. I've seen it on CAPTCHAs. Can I also show the portion of code which allows the JSON request in the Git? Is a question I just got from stream. The reason why we can do the code inside of the Git request is literally because it's in the API route. Any Laravel API will allow this. So it's an easy mistake, and yeah. We could dig through all of Laravel. I think OXDF did on his blog, like dug into exactly why that happened. Let's see, OXDF, GitHub, ransom. If we look at his blog, let's see. Beyond root, he's looking at route, request handling. He's talking about it here. Input, let's see. So it's going into Symfony and it goes into debugging here. So if you really want to see exactly why Laravel does that, that would probably be the best resource. I just knew it from when I was creating machine, like I created a Laravel machine before this machine and I noticed that little weird quirk. So I dug into it. And yeah, so hope you guys enjoyed that small segment.